Welcome to HR Studio Podcast. Through bi-weekly interviews with HR executives, thought leaders, authors, speakers, and trend spotters from the world of HR and beyond, we invite you to listen, learn, and leverage. Welcome to HR Studio Podcast, building the next generation of HR leaders. HR Studio Podcast is brought to you by AJ O'Connor Associates, a trusted human capital consulting partner to emerging, mid-market, and world-class organizations. To learn more, visit us at ajoconnor.com.
So welcome, everyone, to HR Studio Podcast. My name is Fred Bunsa, and I'm going to be your host for today's episode. Today, our thought leader is Dana Wright Wasson, and Dana is a global OD consultant who leads clients through transformational processes around strategic planning, employee engagement, and leadership. And Dana has an amazing passion around creating amazing employee experiences. And she believes pretty wholeheartedly that engagement is actually an outcome. It's an effect of the way people are treated in organizations. And that kind of a point of view obviously has implications for how Dana works with her clients. She's the CEO of Take Action, Inc., and she's also the founder of Work Happy Project. She's been a visual practitioner for over 20 years, and she has her BA in psychology, and she's got her master's in organizational development. And when she's not working with clients, she is traveling the world. 38 countries, is that the current count, Dana, of how many countries you've been to?
I think that's current, yes.
That is awesome. So Dana, welcome to HR Studio Podcast.
Thank you, glad to be here.
Awesome. So you've written this book, Talk the Walk, Designing a Clear Path to a World-Class Employee Experience. And that's actually what I want to talk to you about. No surprise there. So my first question is, what is employee experience? I don't know if you have your own definition for it. And then how is it a more effective way to address employee engagement than doing surveys?
Great question. Thanks for asking about employee experience. For me, I don't know if it's my definition or if it's the standard definition. I know that employee experience is just starting to be talked about in the HR circles and in organizations. To me, employee experience is the entire cycle of an employee's time with a company, whether it's a small company or a multinational company. It's the first touch point that they have with that company, from trying to get hired through the onboarding process, and then all the experiences that they have within the company all the way until the day that they walk out that door, whether it's through retirement or starting another job or going out on their own. That's the experience that they have. All of those touch points make up the employee experience.
Okay. And so what's your, talk us through your connection between that and engagement and why surveys are not, in your view, as effective as most people might think they are.
Right. Well, I've been doing work in companies for a long time around employee engagement surveys. So here's what happens typically in a company. They run an employee engagement survey, typically annually. They spend a lot of money, put a lot of resources behind running this survey. It's a huge logistical nightmare to get everybody to fill out a survey, not think it's a waste of time, tabulate, get the results out, and then try to do something about it. And it's that last part that I really watched companies struggle with. You know, what do? We all know how to take surveys. Leaders love numbers. They love trends. They love to see patterns and things like that. But you're talking about people. And so how do you get those numbers to translate into things that you can do something about with respect to people? And I've noticed, you know, a lot of these companies, as I said, do these annual surveys. Sometimes now they're doing pulse surveys, but it all drops when they have to figure out, how do we connect this number that we got with the people that we're talking to? And we're, you know, trusting that the survey is actually asking the right questions. And what I've found is a lot of times the questions that need to be asked aren't being asked. And so if the question's not on the survey, Gallup, for example, has their famous Q12. So they've narrowed down to 12 questions that they think really are the core questions that measure engagement. But if the issue that employees are having doesn't happen to fall into one of those 12 categories, you've just missed it. Mm-hmm. And so how do you create that conversation really with the employees that is either additive to the survey or maybe on the side of the survey that really gets the conversation going about how can we create a better workplace.
Okay, so are you recommending then that companies don't survey, or they just do it differently, or they take the results and do something with them that they're not currently trying?
I think they have to look at surveys in terms of a bigger picture. You don't want to create what's called survey fatigue, where people are just taking the survey and they say, nothing happens with this, so let's just put all of our numbers in the middle, or we'll really lowball our score and get our leader in trouble. You know, you don't want people gaming the survey, because that's a waste of everybody's time, right? But I think that there needs to be more thought into how can we create the conversations with people that we need to be having. So using the survey as a springboard for having those meaningful conversations between team leaders and their team, cross leadership, looking organizationally at what are the trends that we're seeing, and figuring out how to make the numbers come alive and have real meaning. Just setting aside the survey as being the be all end all tool.
Okay. And what we really measuring in these surveys is how happy an employee is, or is that, like, I don't know, how do you even look at what it is we're actually getting a bead on in those surveys?
Yes. Well, it depends on what the questions are, right? And sure. I have a great ongoing dialogue with one of my colleagues who came out of Unilever, actually, and he really doesn't like the term happiness. He says, you know, it's not our job as companies to make employees happy. That's an individual thing, right? And we all know about the Sean Aker stuff, and there's a set point of happiness, and what is the role of a company in making an employee happy? So I think we've kind of meandered down a strange path around definition of happiness, but I think of it more related to company goals. So how do you make employees productive? How do you create an environment where they can be innovative, feel like their results matter, feel like they're making progress against goals? So I don't like to get pigeonholed into the pocket of happiness. For some people, being productive does mean happiness.
That's right. Yeah,
being innovative does mean happiness. But I don't want to define everybody as engagement equals happiness, because it's not really that way.
Okay. Do you have a working definition that you use about, you know, what really employee experience or employee engagement is about, or do your clients define it and then you help them measure that?
Yeah, well, I mean, my definition, and I'm using my the infographic, is really that total collection of things that contribute to that experience.
Okay.
And for me, it is not just the experience and sort of that employee life cycle, the wheel that I think of. But it's also the culture of the organization. What kind of culture are somebody stepping into? Is it a culture of fear? Is it a culture that welcomes creativity and innovation? What types of leaders are there? Is the message we're getting from the culture that you can be innovative, but you have leaders who actually punish you for taking a step out too far?
Right.
So are the leaders being innovative? Are they trusting people to do a good job? And then what's that work environment set up to achieve?
Okay.
And that can go everything from the physical environment. Do you walk in and you feel like, you know, this is a happy, going back to that word, if this is a happy workplace and people, you know, there's a buzz, or does it feel very daunting, like, God, get me out of here?
So let's drill in a little bit on the idea around leaders. How is it, they definitely set the tone, but are they truly responsible for the culture or the employee experience?
No, I don't think leaders are. I mean, there's an expression that says it's really the CEO who sets the culture. So the CEO and really his top echelon of leaders that he surrounds himself with are the people who are setting the culture. What's acceptable, what's not acceptable. And I think that there's several different people responsible for how that employee experience gets carried out. So I think the CEO has a role, again, in culture. I think the leaders all have a role in how they're running their teams and how collaborative and innovative they're allowing them to be. I think HR has a role, but it's not the role that's typically put on HR. So a lot of these things come down And I've been in HR. It often like all falls right there and they're at the bottom of the mosh pit, right?
Yeah.
And really HR, they don't have that much control day to day over the experience that employees have. So really the HR role is to get a pulse of what's going on around them, both in the organization and what's the competition doing. You know, if you're sitting in Silicon Valley and you work at some small startup, you better be looking at what the Googles and the Apples and the eBays are doing, because the employees that you're hoping to attract are used to that sort of environment.
Mm-hmm.
So HR really has that type of role, and they have to be very careful about the leaders that they're hiring, because those leaders are going to set the tone for those teams. So if they are not training, promoting, hiring, et cetera, the leaders that they want to have at that organization, you know, things are going to go downhill very fast. But I don't put everything on HR. HR cannot wholly and solely be responsible for the experience employees have.
So when you're working with organizations, do you give them any advice or you know, for our podcast listeners, many of whom are in the HR space, what do you look for? So you're hiring for sort of cultural fit or the aspirational values that the organization wants to drive, and you're training for other things, or how do you have them approach that?
Well, when I'm working with HR, I really help them to become partners in kind of a consultative role, right? So they help to do a cultural audit and see what is the culture? What is the culture that we have today? What's the culture that we're trying to get to? Working, and so they can be consulting with their leadership in starting to do that assessment. So they're providing information and starting that conversation. They also can be mindful about the types of leaders that they have in their organization, that they want in their organization, and figure out what the changes are that they need to make, and what are the skills that they need to be training for? What are they lacking? And what type of coaching needs to be happening with the current leaders? So for example, Google, when they did employee survey, when they did engagement surveys, if there was a leader that was struggling with something, Google would spend the time and effort to hire a coach to work with them one-on-one for a set period of time.
Right.
And then when the next, and it was great because, you know, they were saying, hey, we really want to support you. You're not demonstrating by your team's feedback the values that we are trying to promote in this organization. But we're going to give you a set period of time to work with somebody and try to get better. And if at the next cycle they weren't better, they left. They were not leaders anymore at Google. So it was a supportive role, but there's an accountability, if that makes sense.
No, it makes a lot of sense. It's impressive when an organization takes seriously the scores and the direction that the organization is heading in. And if people aren't, managers could be otherwise, quote unquote, effective in driving their projects or their results.
Yes.
But if they're not doing it in the way that aligns with the organizational values or their mission, that they actually do something about that.
Right, exactly. And the other role that I love to take on with HR is train them to be facilitators and having those conversations with employees. So we do what are called listening sessions. And so it's a structured conversation that we have. It's a 90-minute process where they ask questions to employees that's sort of the live version of an employee engagement survey. And so they ask them about the work environment. What's the communication like? What's the recognition system that you're seeing? How is change handled? You know, the primary areas that really trip up people from feeling engaged. And I have gotten feedback from those facilitator HR folks. So they're internal HR people who are trained to facilitate these sessions. And they say, this is such a rewarding part of our job now, because HR has often been relegated into that police role. So they're doing the things that are not the fun things and not the people things. And people who are attracted to HR are people. You know, they're people, right? They like people. And to only see, you know, it's like police work. You only see the bad things of people rather than the good things. And this really was inspirational to them because they got to work together and they got to work with people and hear about how they could start making changes. So it didn't feel so daunting.
Interesting. And so you provide them some kind of a structure to have these kinds of check-in conversations?
Yes. Yeah. So we train them on not only the facilitation skills, but what that conversation actually looks like. And we structure it very carefully so that they have a roadmap and a template to follow. And there's something about making those conversations visual that really helps people. It's a funny thing when people can let go of something that has been held deep inside of them for a while. They just didn't have an outlet to be able to share it. We've had sessions where people have come up to us at the end and said, I feel so much better. For 30 years, I have had this in my heart and my head, and now I can go back to work and feel like something's going to be done. And it's just like, there's nothing more powerful in the world, especially as a people person, to hear somebody say what you just did, that 90 minutes just made a huge difference in my life.
Yeah. And do you have to be someone who can, you know, be artistic to do these visual sessions with
employees? No, because the visual is already created for you. And so really their job is simply to scribe into the template that's created. Yeah.
Okay. And Dana, do those sessions, is it the conversation is going to be similar regardless of the organization because those core issues are the same, or is a conversation, you know, with a high-tech West Coast company going to be very different than a Midwest manufacturing company, for instance?
Yeah, no, the conversations are the same because the areas are the core areas, you know, around those things like change management and communication and recognition and leader effectiveness. All of those are just the very base things that either create engagement or disengagement for people.
Okay, good. And let's circle back to talk the walk. What would you say are the one or two big ideas here that that prompted you and motivated you to write the book?
Well, it was years of doing this process and doing this work with organizations that really prompted me to want to pull it all together and have it all in one place. Mm-hmm. I think the two core things are tying in what seems to me obvious, but as I said earlier, the need to look at the leadership that an organization has as well as the culture, because that together are really the gears that set that employee experience in motion.
Okay.
And the second thing is, it was really my just graduated daughter who pointed out to me that all along I have been using design thinking principles and not realizing it. So, you know, pulling over the customer experience stuff that we've been doing for a while with customers and trying to become empathetic and understanding, looking through the customer's eyes, what they need and want. All you have to do is pull that indoors, right? If you're in an organization, just look at having the same sorts of conversations, being empathetic with your employees and, you know, going back to that first day. What was that first experience like with the organization? What was the onboarding? Was it a good experience? Did you feel like you were really welcomed, or did you feel like you had just been thrown to the wolves? You have no systems, no processes, you know, you just kind of don't know anything and you're expected to just get up and start running.
Yeah. So. And so you've made some connections between design thinking methodologies as a way to sort of assess and improve employee experience.
Yes, correct.
Let's talk a little bit about how you've done some of those things.
Well, going back to those listening sessions, so those really are just doing that first stage of design thinking, which is really being empathetic and listening and asking good questions. Mm. And then pulling in all that information and starting to look at what are the changes that we could make, not wholesale overhaul, you know, let's dump this organization and create a new one, but what are the few, we'd narrow it to 3 to 5 things that would really make a significant step change in our organization for people. And what we do is we involve the employees in that conversation. So we have them look at their own data from their own listening session as well as other listening sessions that happen in the organization. And we have them sort out and say, what are the most important things that we need to address, and then figuring out what the solutions are. So at the point that they do that, they feel such ownership for how to make those changes. And we get leaders involved in helping them. So it becomes a real cross collaboration and not an us versus them, but it's really a we. How do we improve the organization for the better?
Have you worked with organizations where HR partners up with people who are literally doing, you know, design thinking and software development to collaborate and to share and to learn from them?
No, I mean, I've done a little bit of work with Google around the design thinking and some of their processes, but not specifically projects on my own, no.
Okay. Is there anything else, Dana, that in terms of your experience with working in organizations through this process, are there any tips or tricks that you can give our you know, audience of HR practitioners to say, if you know, if you're going to set these sessions up, be careful of this or make sure you do that?
Yes, absolutely. I think a couple of tips and tricks I have come to over the years is, one, allow the ability for everyone to participate. And at the same time, so in other words, our tendency would be to want to bring in the people that we like or think like us or don't cause trouble. And it's actually better to bring in the people, sprinkle in a few of those that cause trouble. Because if you can win them over, and the process really does that because of the setup and the conversation that ensues, they become your biggest advocates, right? And at the end, we say to them, you know, it's easy to gossip. And when you go back to the office, there's going to be plenty of people who are going to try to drag you to that dark side again. And you can't let them, because you're now on this bridge where you have seen that collaboration and these ideas really can take you forward. And so getting them into a different mindset really engages the disengaged, if that makes sense.
Yeah. Well, it's like, you know, keep your friends close and your enemies closer. So it's into the process, and the process itself will... Well, first of all, you'll hear what's driving their concerns, to be kind, or their their angst.
Right.
And if nothing, and the additional benefit I hear you saying, Dana, is that that having them talk through this visual process could actually win them over.
Absolutely. And it does. And then they become the big cheerleaders rather than having to drag them along.
That's awesome.
So it's really powerful. I mean, there's been times at the end where we're actually, as facilitators, having worked with this team for a full day, I mean, we're in tears listening to them because they have really embraced it. And what's really powerful is when they do that and they're presenting to their leaders, the leaders see a different person. So if they've pigeonholed somebody into, you know, this is a troublemaker or this guy's a bad egg or whatever, they see this person in a different light and it kind of resets their lens, which is really powerful as well.
That is really cool.
Yeah.
That is really cool. How about one thing not to do if they were going to pull these sessions together?
One thing not to do, I would say we've had experiments where we tried shortening the sessions, and that's a bad thing. I mean, we've really timed it 90 minutes for the listening sessions is really critical because it gets enough time for people to feel like they've been heard, but not, obviously, most people wouldn't try to make it longer. And that would drag things out. But shorter makes people feel like you're not really there to listen to them. You're more there to run a process.
Yeah, you wanna be able to say that we had listening sessions when really you were just doing sort of a walkthrough tour of places.
Yeah. Exactly.
So you mentioned, Dana, it's a day session, but you said it's 90 minutes. So you're just having back-to-back-to-back sessions with various employee groups?
Right. Well, it's two parts, so I wasn't very clear about that. The listening sessions are 90 minutes, and we have multiple listening sessions with about 15 or so employees at a time.
Okay.
The full day is actually a full day of reviewing the listening session outcome and then figuring out what problems we want to solve. So it's everybody gets to participate, and then we narrow it down to just 20 people who can be the eyes and the ears of the organization, a good mix of people that can start to sort out problems and come up with solutions.
I see. So of all the groups of employees who may have gone through it, you're selecting about 20 to speak for their peers, speak on behalf of their peers, their colleagues.
Yep.
Okay.
And we do warn them at the beginning not to pull in their own personal agenda, but they're really wearing the hat of all the employees that aren't there in the room.
So yeah, so it's not a platform for their own, you know, we need to change the menu in the cafeteria and I'm finally got a chance to speak my piece about that.
Yes.
Okay,
yes.
That's good.
Well, and the other caution I would have for HR folks is there's a fear on the part of the HR people as well as leaders that they're afraid people, when they come together, all they're going to be asking for is money. And I have to say, in all the time I have been doing this, I think that's only come up once. So engagement's not about money. There's a cap. You know, if people aren't feeling they're being paid fairly, that's a different thing. That's a compensation issue. But most of the time, it's things like there's not food in the cafeteria that I can eat, or sick days are not administered fairly and evenly across, you know, it's solvable things. It's not money. Yeah.
So get, what I hear you saying is kind of get over that fear, bring people together, have a structured process where they can speak from the heart about these issues, and they'll show up and they'll stand up in a way that's can be quite surprising.
Exactly. Yeah, that's exactly. Awesome. Yeah.
Good. Well, Dana, any final thoughts as we wrap up our podcast here, any final thoughts for our audience of rising HR leaders and leaders in general about what they can do to drive employee experience?
I mean, I think the biggest thing I would say is don't be afraid to talk to people. Creating forums where people can have back and forth dialogue and feel free that they can express not only the good things, but the things that are not working, that's a healthy environment. Mm-hmm. And in fact, one of the things I'll always say to leaders as we do these sessions is, be really grateful that you're getting all this feedback, because the opposite is having people give you nothing. And that means that they've just absolutely given up hope, or worse yet, you know, the expression we used to say, and I don't remember when, now I don't want to think about what we call it, is, you know, going postal. You know, the idea that somebody is so wound up that they're ready to spring. Mm-hmm. And so it's much better to have that feedback coming in and providing a forum where you can get that and do something productive with it is so much healthier. And people are so grateful. You know, they will, for HR people, you're people, and it's so great to be able to talk with the people who work with you and give them a forum to be able to say, hey, this isn't working for me, and feel like they're listened to. It's a win-win for everybody.
Awesome. Well, Dana, thank you so much for the great conversation that we've had today. And for those of you who'd like to learn more about Dana and to have a link to her book, Talk the Walk, and you're not already a subscriber to HR Studio Podcast, we would have all of our show notes there, hrstudiopodcast.com. And there you'll be able to see links to Dana, to her social handles. And Dana's been kind enough to give us two copies of her book, Talk the Walk, Designing a Clear Path to a World-Class Employee Experience. And we're going to be giving those away to two random HR Studio Podcast subscribers. So if you're not a subscriber already, sign up, and we'll have a drawing to choose two of them for Dana to receive her book. Dana, thank you for donating those books to us. We really appreciate it. And thank you so much, especially for joining us on the podcast today. We really appreciate it.
Great. Thanks for having me.
All right. Take care.
Okay. Bye-bye.
Welcome to HR Studio Podcast. Through bi-weekly interviews with HR executives, thought leaders, authors, speakers, and trend spotters from the world of HR and beyond, we invite you to listen, learn, and leverage. Welcome to HR Studio Podcast, building the next generation of HR leaders. HR Studio Podcast is brought to you by AJ O'Connor Associates, a trusted human capital consulting partner to emerging, mid-market, and world-class organizations. To learn more, visit us at ajoconnor.com.